Pushing distance from each other, but involve themselves in working together. For an institution like this, for an engineering college, which is similar to yours, there are many questions. How do you promote research? Why is research not happening in the university sector? So I have a few questions. How do you promote R&D in a non-residential institution? Why are the IIMs and the IITs residential institutions? Because the faculty and students in a non-residential institution have to travel long distances. By the time they come to the college, they are tired. By the time they go to the college, they are tired. And impossible to do experimental research. Now, many people talk about using the mobile phone to give educational content to the students while they are traveling to and fro. Is that really realistic? I'm not sure it is. How do you promote R&D in an undergraduate institution? It is not sufficient advanced knowledge percolating through that institution for people to think about innovation and R&D. How do you promote R&D in an institution with very few faculty having a PhD? You know, all the engineering colleges, for instance, and the management institutions, now the accreditation criteria, the demand, that the faculty members must have a PhD. Why should they have a PhD? This is the question asked by many of the institutions, not so much the faculty members, but by the administration. The reason for that is they don't have sufficient knowledge in order to communicate with each other and take advantage of the peer-to-peer interaction. How do you promote R&D in an institution with heavy teaching loads? Why are the teaching loads heavy? Because of faculty shortages, excessive admissions, temporary faculty working as on contract basis. This is a fact which is happening in a majority of our institutions, unfortunately. How have R&D and innovation evolved in India, industrial consultancy and so on? During the early years, 1970s, for instance, there was a principle which governed the performance and the activities of faculty members. That is, publish or perish. Publish papers in good journals, and if you don't, then you won't get promoted, and therefore you perish. Later, in the 1980s, consultancy also became important. Publish and consult or perish. It's not enough if you publish papers. You must give industry or the user agency your knowledge in order to achieve solutions, and that is consultancy. In recent years, post-WTO, patents first so that you protect your intellectual property, then publish and prosper. Why should you perish? At the moment, there is an open source revolution. It says publish, share, and feel good. There are many, many open journals. And in electrical engineering, for example, in electronics, there is the Explore, which is in which if you publish, you get a recognition. I want to leave you coming to the question of competitiveness with the concept of benchmarking. Benchmarking is something extremely important for businesses. The essence of benchmarking is articulated in the following fashion. There's a practice of being humble enough to admit that someone else is better at something, and being wise enough to try to learn how to match and even surpass them at it. Somebody's making a better car, you study the principles behind why it is a better car, and then you incorporate those principles in your own manufacturing and other activity. That is benchmarking. In education, you look at another institution which is doing better than what you're doing, and then import those practices into your own institution. I'll give you one example. I'm a great believer in benchmarking. Whenever I go to different institutions, I look at the major improvement that they are making, major quality aspects of what they are doing, and try to preach that to your own institution or to other institutions. Even in the manner of, for example, hostel management. We used to have messes where about 1,000 people used to have to eat at one time. So how do you organize the mess operations? How do you make sure that the place is clean? There are ways of doing that. You have to look, particularly good corporate houses, if you look at their messes in the canteens, you can learn a lot from it. How to organize the tables and how to organize the cooking, how to organize the cleaning, which is very much more important than cooking. Now, in terms of business, there is an excess between business goals and benchmarks. Particularly in industry, they will not have one institution with which they would benchmark. For different aspects of operation of that institution, they will have different benchmarks. With MIT in one aspect, with an IIT in another aspect, some other college, NIT for instance, in another aspect. Not all of them need to be related to the same institution. I'll give you some examples. If your business goal is to be the lowest price producer, obviously you have to focus on cost. The material cost per product, the labor cost per product, and other costs, indirect costs. If you want to maintain an increased market share, you'll be looking at the following. You'll be looking at customer service, you would be looking at product or service functionality, and you would be looking at product development time. So there are other examples I have here. Therefore, benchmarking is extremely important. You should choose the right institutions and the right characteristics of those institutions which will make you competitive. So what I've tried to give you now is a few ideas about the roles of technology and innovation and also benchmarking in achieving business competitiveness. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for your inspiring words. And from the faculty fraternity, I will promise that we will publish and prosper, sir, and will not perish. Thank you so much, sir. And next, I would like to introduce the guest of honor of today, Sri M.N. Vidyashankar, who joined IAS Services in 1982. He has an M.A. degree in economics and M.Phil degree from Delhi School of Economics, University of Delhi. He has a post-graduation degree from Harvard University, U.S., one of the prestigious institutions. He served in different departments of state government and government of India, and he was a chairman for BWSSB, and he was a commissioner for BDO. He has worked as chief electoral officer, Karnataka, principal secretary, Department of E-Governance, and the Department of Information Technology, Biotechnology, and Science and Technology, Government of Karnataka. Over a long stint, and worked as an additional chief secretary of Government of Commerce and Industrial Department. He holds as chairman and director positions for more than a dozen of boards and corporations for both national and multinational companies. And he is right now working as a president, India Electronics and Semiconductor Association, a premier national business trade body in electronics and semiconductor space. I welcome you, sir, and I would request you to address the guest.
Dr. Natarajan, my good friend, Mrs. Srina, Dr. Venkatesh, August members in the audience, a very good afternoon to each one of you. Okay, let me digress a little bit. I don't believe in a monologue, I believe in a dialogue. I'll make it as interactive as possible. You have been hearing about innovation, competitiveness, you have been hearing about how do we take ourselves forward, but I'll try to slightly change the focus and ultimately come down to the topic that you are going to discuss and deliberate over the next 2 days. I'm sure you are currently being overloaded with this Make in India logo. You are reading about it, you are talking about it, you are sharing about it. And I'm sure you will also be wondering, why is it that there's so much talk about Make in India? And the purpose why I'm dwelling on this is that in this August gathering, even if 5% of the gathering can evangelize on Make in India, I think my purpose of coming here would have been served, and you would have done a human service for the country, and I'll tell you why. Since Mr. Srinathan and Evangelizer, in fact, I told him, we want more of you in the country. And why is it that we want more of you? And that's what I'm going to tell you in the next 15 to 20 minutes. I'll share some facts with you because it's very important for you, each one of you, to know about our country. As of April 2015, I'm talking of the present year, the total imports of the country, what we get from the rest of the world, was about $500 billion US dollars. And the kind of exports that we do from the country to the rest of the world is about $310 billion. So there's a gap of about $200 billion. Now, out of the $500 billion that you import, half a trillion that you import, which is the largest item accounting for imports? Yes, crude oil, petrol, which is about $120 to $125 billion as of March. Not today. You know why? The prices have come down from 122 dollars per barrel to about $60 to $65 per barrel. So 120 will ultimately come down to a much smaller figure. Now, which is the second most important item that we import? I thought the response will come from the woman folk. It's gold. Okay. Now, we import gold worth about $90 billion. So imagine 120 oil, 90 billion gold, and which is the third item? There's a catch. That's the topic which you're discussing now. Okay, not technology but in particular, but a very important component for technology, which is electronics. Okay, we currently import about $80 billion of goods in terms of electronics. Now, if you look at the rate of growth of, our consumption of electronic goods, if the same rate of growth continues in the next 4 to 5 years' time, the electronics import will overtake oil import by 2020, which is about just 5 years away. Imagine the condition of our Indian economy where today we are struggling with an oil import bill of $120 billion. We are struggling because we don't produce much oil and our demand for oil is increasing because we are getting into a much higher level of platform in terms of economic growth and development. Naturally, energy will be a very important component of our consumption. So imagine what will happen after 4 years if electronic import will overtake $120 billion, and how are we going to afford this kind of an economy which is totally unsustainable looking at the way we are currently functioning, and hence Make in India. Now, in this August gathering, I'm sure you know one of the questions I asked Purnima Reddy and Dr. Venkatesha, and including Dr. Srinivasa, do you have a placement cell? You have a placement cell? Exactly. Now, that is our enemy. I'm sure none of you will agree with me. That is our enemy. If only we scrap this placement cell, you will know how different we make in India be. Okay, we have done a very analysis at depth, in depth, as to why is it that, you know, this placement cell is trying to ruin the kind of creativity, the kind of innovative spirit of Indians. You know, people said that we do very well in the Silicon Valley, but we don't do as well in India. Why? It's because of the placement cell. Now, before 1997, when this entire campus recruitment, I'm sure the word you love it, but I hate it. Campus recruitment, the moment I complete my graduation, I complete my post-graduation, I have Infosys, I have TCS, I have Wipro at my door, knocking at my door and then saying, I want to recruit 40 students from this prestigious institution. That is the thing which is ruining us. Before 1997, out of every 100 engineers that India produced, 28 became entrepreneurs. Okay, 2015, it is 6. Why is it that we are not becoming entrepreneurs? Why is it that we are not making for our own country? Because I have a cushy job which gives me 30K, 35K, and in about 5 years' time, close to about 100,000 Indian rupees in my pocket, I consider I have made my life. Okay, there is nothing that I need to learn, and whatever I need to do, I have done. Whatever I need to learn, I have learned. That's the end of it, and campus recruitment is the one which is literally killing us, killing the innovative spirit in the country, which is killing the entrepreneurial spirit in the country. Of course, you know, your question would be, you are trying to compare apples and oranges, because 1997, the total number of engineers was X. Today, it is 10X. So maybe in absolute terms, you have as many. But the thing is, even our population is also increasing. Now, we need to take care of the next generation. See, that's the reason why we need to take this very, very seriously. Now, if you, I keep telling people, you know, I visit at least 2 to 3 educational institutions every week. And I normally don't say no when I get an invitation from an education institution to share my thoughts, primarily because of this reason, because we don't want job seekers in the country, we want job creators. If you can create jobs for others, I think we would have done the kind of duty that our next generation expects from us, your own brothers, your own sisters, your own, you know, cousins and so on and so forth. And if you want to have job creators, we need to have, you know, as I said, you have to come out, swim on your own, see what best suits you. If only you can convert your passion into a business sense, I think we would have done our duty insofar as our next generation is concerned. Now, what I'm giving is at a 30,000 feet view, saying that we need to be entrepreneurs to ensure that we create more jobs and ensure that, you know, today, you know, there are, you'll be surprised to know, why is it that we are not doing it when very small countries are doing, creating wonders in the world? I'm sure each one of you, if not each one of you, most of you have an Apple phone. Okay? Now, Apple is designed in. I'm saying designed in. See, there's a difference between design and manufacturing. It is designed in US, okay? But made in China. Unfortunately, people get blurred. It is not made in China. Okay? You must have seen it, heard it, sorry? You must have seen it, heard of a country called Taiwan, which is very close to China. Okay? China claims Taiwan to be a part of it, but you must have heard of a company by the name Foxconn in the recent past. Okay? Now, Foxconn is the one which is 100% of the cell phones, so 100% of iPhones that you and I use every day. Now, the way the business is changing over the world, iPhone 6 Plus, which costs $499, you know how much the Foxconn factory gets out of $499? It gets $9. $9 out of $499 only goes to Foxconn factory. The remaining 490, you know, components, shipment, logistics, packing, packaging, and so on. And Apple gets $290 out of $499, which does not own a factory. It only designs. It only has an IP. So look at the way the global scenario is changing. In fact, Mr. Srinath refers to Airbnb, okay, bed and breakfast. There are companies today, if you look at the economic scenario globally, why is it that, one gentleman asked about a question about technology. I don't think he's here. He's not here, no? In fact, he asked a question, despite all the technology, what is happening? The response is, it's happening because you are not using technology. Okay, if you use technology, you will not have these kind of scenarios. Okay, today, I very passionately, very sincerely believe that technology has solutions for every problem that we have. But are we in a position to make use of technology to the hilt? Are we in a position to make use of technology to serve